I'm ready, Josh.
Well, I did a little break before we continue on. Here's the thing you got.
I just want to make sure that this is working.
We could do while Mr. Benedict is getting ready. Let me just stand up. Let me stand up and try to grab this. Silent. The gallery is cordially invited to participate. You, as the case progressed, can find out that there's a lot more to this case than the past week. And when you find out all those things, I don't think there's going to be much of an issue that you're going to come back with in my room. The reality is, most of the important facts in this case came out through cross-examination or through defense witnesses. They're told to tell the truth and the whole truth. Not the whole truth. The whole truth. If somebody tells you a half truth, it's misleading. You know, the very last witness the state called was John LeMay. John's an honest guy. He came in here and he told you. Did tell me what happened on May 20th, 2013. And if you go by John's memory, which was first job in 2017, Devon Beta wasn't there because he only remembers Tom coming. Well, you know, sometimes they ask a question of a witness and there's a reason for it. But you don't really Justin Byers was asked by me a number of questions about certification that he signed back in June of 2013 when all of this was happening. And I specifically asked him about who was there, and I referred him to a certification where he agreed, he said, Schaefer, Surina, an unknown individual, myself sat in the back of the store as Schaefer handed the gold certificates to Surina. That's that fourth unidentified individual. The fact that crime, memory, 5-6 years after the incident is different. Doesn't change the fact that Bob was there. It's a misdirection. It's trying to present you with a half truth. John doesn't.
statement that I wasn't even going to talk about when you left. I just told you a little story about Lincoln, the debate, the guy who tried to make a little too much of the facts, you know, Lincoln caught him up, showing that just because he says something, that doesn't make it true. And I said, well, let's wait for the 11th. And we let it lived up to the building on me. We talked about whether or not he had a retainer. He said, and he didn't, but he told you it wasn't necessary. Well, Mr. Wax, we all agreed he was an expert on professional responsibility. He said, yes, you have to have a retainer. When this is the first time you're dealing with a client. And we found out from the testimony of Mr. Benedict why it's important. Because I questioned him about charging Lisa Linda $875 for doing NL9. The L9, which is in evidence, you'll get to see it. Was filled out by him in handwriting location. The next page, she's the beneficiary. Where is that? That's at the top. She's the beneficiary. You check a couple of blocks as to what is supposed to be attached, and lo and behold, she signs it. You know what? Lee Levitt could have given her that document as it was filled out just then, and she could have mailed it in. Says there should be a couple of attachments, the same attachments she would have had when she prepared the estate. And it calls for a federal income tax return if there is one. Instead, he charged her $875 to go back to his office and have it typed up. So I'm questioning about why he would charge her that much money for that little work. He said, well, you know, maybe if I had a retainer agreement, it would have spelled out more, because actually it did more work for him. Well, he charged the Burks the fee for representing her. So if you claim what he charged the Burks, and he charged her $1,400. Well, you know, the $900, because there was another $2,500 he charged her for drafting the deed, she could have had her own attorney. She should have had her own attorney. But she didn't. She relied on the Burks and Mr. Levitt. She didn't even know that she paid this guy any money. You heard her testimony. Well, I didn't get a bill. No, you took that out of the closing. Did you? Was he representing you? Well, that's probably why I signed that waiver, but she doesn't really know for sure. Now, why am I so concerned about the letter? Because he has a key role in this case. He's the one who, when he talks to Lisa Linder, starts negotiating with her for the share of any proceeds. Very successful in the civil case. And why? Because in the course of the conversation,
Lisa Linda, who never knew there was a safe in the house. Lisa Linda, who never heard about a gold certificate, is now talking to Lee Levin about gold certificates. And we admit she's the one who used that language. I have her. She only knew about bonds, who now they're all savings bonds for her friend, Jim Delphoe. But by the end of the conversation, it is grandma's safe and grandma's gold certificates. That's the theory of the case that Lee Levin crafted for his clients, the Burks. The theory that they stayed with right through getting Lisa Linda 2015 to sign an agreement. And what's interesting about this agreement is that she's signing it on behalf of Grandma's estate. They want, and I don't know what the state's position is on this. They claim that the theft committee is for theft. But they claim that that was from either Lisa or John Burke. But this theory is that that was from Grandma. And that was the creation of Lee Levin. In this contract, incidentally, Lisa Linda told us it was signed either on the day or shortly after Mr. Wolf became her attorney. Who else does Mr. Wolf represent? The Burks. I asked Lee Levin about what buyers told him when he called up and he described the certificates. And he described them as circulated, abused. But when he prepared the certification for Mr. Byers, he put in fairly good shape. Of course, Byers, being Byers, he's all Byers, he just signed this thing. It's the same certification where at least he told a few things that were true. While we were cleaning, Schaefer came across the old lot statement. Yeah, the Burks found the perfect lawyer in the left. Managed to talk to pretty much all of the witnesses very early on, some cases before they were interviewed by Detective Bird. And just a very quick comment about Detective Bird. They asked her about the difference between what Mr. Burke told Officer Walsh and what he's telling her just a week later. He tells Walsh that there's going to be potentially a split if anything's found, and Keith was going to open the safe. That's not what he said. In fact, the Bird, because this is an evolving story, we've got to work this story until we get the facts we need. So in this evolving story, when he talks to Detective Bird, nobody was supposed to touch that safe unless I was there and I was going to get it. A monster. Glaring difference between what he said week before and week later. Detective Bird says, well, I didn't have the Walsh statement in front of me. Out of a pursuit for the truth. Somewhat digressed. types of checks we have, the papers he signed later when he's leaving. I mean, you know, he doesn't try to hide anything, does he? And he says, well, he was moving for him. Now, when he comes before the jury, he says, oh, he's trying to stick it in his jacket. I like that part too. Stick it in his jacket. He described it as a hot, sunny day. Here's a guy down in his basement, banging away for an hour and a half, coming out with a jacket on. Why? Why the lines? I can't explain. And buyers, at least buyers have the decency to admit to you, yes, I lied in my certification. I lied in my statement. I lied in my deposition. Came to on cross-examination that he lied. He lied when he spoke to the detective Luger. And as my, as the other lawyer, the other lawyer, has already pointed out, they don't seem to care about these things. Luger writes a report saying when we interviewed him, it was consistent with what he told us before. No, it's not. The first time you talked to him, he said, oh, I don't know nothing. You know, I don't know anything. Explained to you up here. He said that because he didn't want to get involved. But when they questioned again, he gave them more detail. So it's not consistent. You don't like them. Do they care? Apparently not. Apparently not. I pointed out in my opening that they didn't mention, the state didn't mention Dorothy. They had Dorothy polite. Unless they proved to you beyond any reasonable doubt that Dorothy polite shouldn't be believed, this case is over. It's over. Because Dorothy says, Keith had the right to all the personal property in the house, just get rid of it, other than some memorabilia. Dorothy Clyde indicated she went there one day. Probably didn't go back on other days because it took them 2 weeks for the contract to sale. But she was there that one day. She actually worked in the bedroom, police and living. You know, Lisa's interested in getting the house cleaned up, but she's never there to help. She is not interested in any of this stuff in the house other than a couple of small items of memorabilia. And what Dorothy told us, they were the Michael Jackson doll, which she says she wasn't there when she was in the bedroom. The photos, which she says Lisa got. The communion dress, Lisa saw was stained and agreed she just put it out. And the Mike Piazza cards, which she says she got. Both Levitt and Burke indicate to the extent they talked to her about the memorabilia was just a couple of small items. Not what Lisa Linda eventually told Detective Burke, oh, Keith Schaefer stole my piano, he stole a desk, he stole record albums. The story is just a bomb. Trying to make the guy look like something he's not. He was doing a favor for a friend of a friend. A lot of people like say that Lisa was looking into what it would cost to clean out that house. And it was going to be over $10,000. And think about it. Doesn't that make sense? This is a house that we describe as in places almost up to the ceiling, junk and clutter. This guy agrees to do it for $2,500. He's doing a favor for a friend of a friend. The deal is just the way he described it